Radar in War Thunder can be overwhelming and unintuitive if you're not used to it, but my goal is that by the end of this guide you should be able to use any radar in the game and understand all of its modes and symbology. Radars are incredibly diverse in their functionality, so not everything I talk about will apply to any one radar, but it's good to know about everything. I'll talk about all the keybinds and go over what they do, but I won't suggest where to bind them specifically. Controls are subjective and you should use what works with your layout. If you're short on keys, remember to use key combinations, or you can access all of these controls through the multifunction menu. You can find info about your radar by hovering over it in Hangar X-ray view. Radars can be split into two groups, full-featured radars and radar gunsights. I'll get back to the radar gunsights later. Don't confuse radar with RWR, which is a completely separate system and a topic for another video. If you have a radar but it's turned off, you'll see the standby icon. Use the turn radar on off keybind to toggle the radar into search mode. If your radar does not respond to this key, you probably have a radar gunsight. If you want your radar to be turned on when you spawn in by default, enable automatic activation of radar at mission start and air battle options. While you're here, turn on these cyclic switching and constant elevation options. I have a video explaining what turning these off does, but basically it requires more keybinds but gives you more control over your radar elevation and cursor. Unless you're already comfortable with radars, I recommend not messing with these, they just make things more complicated. This is your radar display. It can either be conical or rectangular depending on how you set the Use Rectangular Radar Indicator option. They both show the same info, but the conical display is pinched together at the bottom and it's also smaller, so I don't use it. The x-axis on a radar display is always azimuth, or left and right relative to your nose, with the center line of the radar matching the center line of your plane. The y-axis is range, unless you're in PDV or IR mode, which I'll get to later. Because of that, you can think of your radar display as a top-down view with your plane at the bottom. Up on the top right is the current range scale. The bottom of the display is 0 kilometers, so the top of the display is whatever you have this set to. If you see an asterisk next to the range scale, it means you can change it using the Change Radar Scope Scale keybind. Set the scope scale too low and targets will be off your display. Set it too high and everything gets cluttered at the bottom. Somewhere around 50 kilometers is usually the sweet spot for me. Opposite your scope scale is the area your radar is scanning and horizontal by vertical degrees. Again, if there's an asterisk, you can change it by using the very confusingly named Change Radar Search Mode key. This key has nothing to do with radar mode and should really be called Change Radar Search Area, but I digress. Look outside your plane and you'll see horizontal and vertical lines matching your radar color. These lines give you a visual for what the current scan area actually looks like. Targets cannot be detected if they're outside this area, so keep that in mind. A wider scan area is good if you're searching for unspotted targets, but a narrow scan area updates the contact more quickly, so use the right scan area for the situation. In the middle of the display is your radar mode. I'll talk about mode in a second, but for now we're just talking about search modes. And this is the elevation indicator. A very small number of displays have a secondary display called a C-scope, which shows elevation on the y-axis. You can visualize this as the view looking out the front of your plane, with the cross more or less matching your plane's bore sight. If your radar picks up a target in search mode, you'll see a contact on your display. The basic radar contact is a horizontal line. Some radars have IFF, or Identification of Friend or Foe. If your radar has this, friendlies will show up as two horizontal lines stacked on top of each other. Using azimuth, as well as your range scale, you can figure out how far away a contact is and where he is relative to your nose. Once you've picked up a contact, you might want to lock him up, which brings me to the topic of radar modes. Radar mode is a term that gets thrown around a lot, and it can describe several different things, so it can get very confusing, but bear with me. Radar mode consists of two components. First is how the radar is interacting with targets in terms of searching, acquiring lock, and tracking, and second is how the radar actually sends out and processes data. We'll get back to the second component in a bit, but first we need to cover how to get a lock. In search or SRC mode, your radar constantly scans for targets and updates their position, but it doesn't engage with them without your input. If your radar has BVR mode listed in the hangar, that means you have the ability to select a target on your display and lock it from search mode. As the name implies, this is usually the only way to get a lock beyond visual range. The currently selected target is bracketed by vertical lines. To cycle through targets, use Select Radar Target to lock. You might find it helpful to switch to narrow scan when trying to get a lock to update the target more quickly and filter out unwanted contacts. When you have a target you want selected, use Lock Radar on Target to attempt a lock. If successful, you will enter track mode. If not, you return to search. Usually lock fails when you're too far away, but it can also be caused by ground clutter or notching, which I'll explain in a bit. Some planes have limited areas where they can use BVR mode, indicated by the darker portion of the display. Picking a target and locking it from search mode is the first way to get a lock, but it can be very inconvenient for locking someone visually at close range, which is where our next mode comes in. ACM or Air Combat Maneuvering mode is your dogfight mode, and it's very simple to use. Put the box over the target, and the radar automatically locks it as long as the radar can see it and it's within range. To enter and exit ACM mode, use Radar Beyond Within Visual Range Combat. In ACM mode, pay attention to the range on the top right, showing how far away ACM works. This can't be changed, so you get what you get. And some radars have Velocity ACM, which has no range limit. Like with search mode, if you see an asterisk next to the scan area, you can change it with Change Radar Search Mode. Usually radars that can do this can switch between a small square, big square, or a tall rectangle. In ACM mode, you can use Lock Radar on Target to turn the radar on and off. You can use the same key to unlock a target as well. This means you can pretty much operate the radar with one key if you want on some planes. I use this all the time on the MiG-23. You'll run into a few planes that list ACM mode but do not have BVR mode, like the Sapphire 21 radar and the MiG-21s. In these cases, you need to use the Lock Radar on Target key to enter ACQ, which is functionally the same as ACM, you just use a different key to access it, which is a little weird, but that's just how it is. The third and final way to lock a target is with HMD or Helmet Mounted Display mode, also called HMS mode in the hangar. This mode is more rare than the first two, but it's one of the most useful if you have access to it. To enter HMD, press Radar Beyond Within Visual Range Combat again after entering ACM mode. Pressing it one more time will return to search, so it goes search, ACM, HMD, back to search. In HMD mode, your radar follows your camera around, but unlike ACM, it does not automatically lock. You have to use the Lock Radar on Target key to attempt to lock. HMD mode is fantastic for getting a lock while you're turning in to fire a radar missile. Regardless of whether you got a lock from search, ACM, or HMD mode, you'll enter TRK or track mode, where your radar focuses all of its energy on tracking one target. You get a box around the target, next to that is range, closure rate, and the tadpole indicator shows relative motion. Down is towards you, right is to your right, and so on, with the length of the arrow indicating relative speed. That indicator is repeated on your radar display. Keep in mind, locking someone up like this will probably set off their RWR. To unlock a target, just use the key you use to get a lock. Lock will be broken if you hit your radar's gimbal limit, or if the target maneuvers into a situation where your radar can no longer track him. So that covers how to search for a target and get a lock. Time for the second radar mode component, which affects how your radar processes data. The names of most of these modes get tacked onto the first part of radar mode. For example, SRC PD, ACM MTI, and so on. Older radars in particular usually can't switch this mode, while newer radars can have as many as 5 or 6. To change between these, use the Change Radar Mode keybind. When you're able to switch mode depends on the radar. Some can only switch while in search mode, while other radars can switch at any time, including while holding a lock. The first radar mode is Pulse, sometimes called Non-Pulse-Doppler to set it apart from Pulse-Doppler. Pulse modes do not have anything added to their name, so if you just see SRC, ACM, HMD, or TRK, it's a Pulse mode. Pulse is usually the only mode you get on older radars. Pulse modes work regardless of which direction the target is flying, but it struggles with returns off the ground, called ground clutter. Ground clutter is indicated by bright areas on your radar, as well as the bars on this indicator. Because of ground clutter, pulse radar, especially on older jets, usually can't see low-flying targets. As radars get newer, pulse modes get better at dealing with ground clutter. Pulse also very easily locks onto chaff, and getting locked back on the target can be tricky, especially if he keeps deploying chaff. If you can't get a lock in pulse mode, either get closer or try to get below your target so you're looking up at him. To deal with the ground clutter limitation of pulse, we have Pulse-Doppler, which usually starts to show up on radars around rank 7. Pulse-Doppler mode names will have PD after the first component of their mode. Pulse-Doppler modes use the relative motion of the target and the Doppler effect to detect and track targets, even ones flying low to the ground, and it's much better at filtering out chaff. However, Pulse-Doppler cannot see targets that are flying perpendicular to you, especially if they're at low altitude. Flying this way to avoid Pulse-Doppler radar is called notching. If you have Pulse-Doppler, it'll probably end up being your main mode, as the benefits outweigh the drawbacks more often than not. Within Pulse-Doppler, there are a couple variations. PDV is Pulse-Doppler Velocity Search. In PDV, you have a unit of speed instead of range on the y-axis. This display does not show range, instead the y-axis shows closure rate. The faster a target is closing in on you, the higher up it will be on the display. There's a common misconception that PDV does not have IFF. It does on some radars. Friendlies are indicated as a little mark towards the top of the display directly above a contact. Some radars have PDV as their only PD search mode, but other radars have the choice. I rarely use PDV in those cases. I prefer normal PD with the range scale. Finally, Pulse-Doppler modes come in two flavors, MPRF or HPRF, which means medium or high pulse repetition frequency. HPRF modes say HDN at the end of their name, which means head-on, and as their name implies, they're optimized for head-ons. all Pulse-Doppler modes work best in head-ons, but HDN modes work even better, having higher detection range. In this example, I cannot find targets at long range, but when I switch to head-on mode, they show up. That's the only advantage of head-on mode as far as I'm aware. If given the choice, I usually use MPRF, also called all-aspect Pulse-Doppler, because it's better at detecting and tracking enemies in more difficult aspects. These modes do not have HDN at the end of their name, they just end in PD. Older Pulse-Doppler radars usually only have head-on mode, while newer radars sometimes have the choice between them. As always, which modes you have access to depends on the radar. Other radar modes you'll run into. MTI or Moving Target Indicator isn't true Pulse-Doppler, but it uses some signal processing wizardry, and the end result is that it works like knockoff Pulse-Doppler in War Thunder. No plane that has MTI also has Pulse-Doppler, so if you have MTI, take advantage of it as your low-altitude mode. The most notorious MTI user is the MiG-23. With this radar, MTI is only available below 1800 meters above ground level. Above 1800 meters, MTI gets replaced with LD or Lookdown, which functionally works the same as normal pulse radar. I believe it's supposed to have some ground clutter mitigation, but in practice I really can't tell a difference. Then there's TWS or Track While Scan, which lets you softlock a target while the radar continues to search. TWS is found with the rest of the search modes, but its name is just TWS. As it's a Pulse-Doppler mode, it may or may not have HDN in its name as well. The TWS target is the one currently bracketed on your radar display. To switch the TWS target, use Change Radar Target to lock. The TWS target has a dashed box around it like this. If the TWS target is beyond the range of the scope scale, the dashes on the box are smaller, covering just the corners, so increase your range scale until you can see it. Using the Lock Radar on Target key will exit TWS and lock the TWS target with a standard track hard lock. TWS can be useful for finding unspotted enemies, but it's most useful for firing active radar homing missiles like the AIM-54 and someday the AIM-120 and R-77. This is because TWS does not set off the lock warning on your enemy's RWR. The last radar mode you might run into is GTM, which I believe stands for Ground Tracking Mode. As far as I know, the only plane that has this is the Su-39 when carrying the radar pod. As the name implies, this is used to find moving ground vehicles. It comes in both search and TWS variants, and you can even lock targets as well. This mode is used to sniff out ground vehicles, although as I haven't used it in actual gameplay, I can't comment on its effectiveness. And at last there's IRST, Infrared Search and Track. This is not a radar mode, but rather an entirely separate sensor that passively detects targets with an infrared sensor. This means IRST does not set off an enemy's RWR at all, and can be used for things like missile slaving and EEGS targeting. To use IRST, press switch between radar and IRST. IRST doesn't show range, so the y-axis on the display is elevation and the cross is the center line, like with the C-scope I mentioned towards the start of the video. Other than that, using it is the same as using radar. You can change scan area, use ACM, even use HMD if you have it. IRST cannot guide radar missiles, so make sure to switch out of it before you go to fire one. If you're in track IR and you try to fire a radar missile, you'll get an error message. Finally, getting back to radar gun sights. These are very small, simple radars. The only interaction is toggling power with lock radar on target. They basically only show range info once you get a lock. They're only useful for radar slaving on jets like the Kafir or J7E. To my knowledge, they don't even help with the cockpit sight in sim like they used to. They set off RWRs and they mess with your missiles on the Swift F7, so I almost always have these turned off. I think that just about covers everything. If you found this video helpful, consider leaving a like and subscribing. It really helps me out. If you have any questions, I will try my best to answer them in the comments. Come hang out on Discord if you want, and thanks for watching.